Is that okay? Okay, guys, thank you for staying back for this session. It's the last session, and it's a Saturday evening. Lots of us like to go out and enjoy ourselves. I'm grateful that you guys are here in this room, and I hope this will not be as boring. Some of the sessions have been really good. So anyway, my name is Sameer. I head a company called Auto. This is pretty much what we do. We have a cloud platform and an Android platform, which we put together as a product platform for companies that have field agents. Okay? We work with those companies which work with the poor. That is, their customers are people who earn about 100 rupees a day. Right? So what kind of companies I'm talking about? I'm talking about microfinance, I'm talking about healthcare, I'm talking about rural supply chain companies. Okay? What's really exciting about the space that we operate in is that we're designing technology for people who've never experienced technology. Right? We're using cutting edge stuff like Android, you know, cloud, the ability to scale up and down, and give it to someone who's never seen something better than an Nokia 2 on table at best. Right? Someone who has a language barrier. And we have so we need to design it that they can use an interface and talk to their customer about it. Right? So they can use this to explain what are the benefits of solar energy based lamps, and then try and sell them to them. Right? They can use this to explain how can that customer do financial planning. Right? So how can they take loans today, they save money tomorrow, and they take insurance and pension to future-proof their lives. Right? So, we are about 2 years old, and we're a young company, we're about 4 people. We recently acquired a very large company, a customer, so not a large company. So we have a lot of money suddenly coming into our company, so that's exciting for us. And we're looking to grow about 10 people in the next 3 months. That's almost 2.5 times our current size. Anyway, so that's a quick intro about us. So I typically program on Android, and it was only very recently that I jumped into the web side of things in a big way. I found this new platform called Play Framework. If you guys develop in Java, you need to check it out. It's called Play Framework or what? Okay. So when I started using Play and started doing all these cool things with it, and remember I'm coming from struts and other things that I don't know, web application. And I realized, wow, Play is a whole new level, right, of web development. And then one day I was sort of looking at, you know, someone else's job description, right? So you're trying to look at what other companies are doing, you're trying to look at their job description and see what technologies are they working with. I suddenly realized a lot of companies our size are using JavaScript.js. Right? To me, JavaScript was like a non-language. Right? It's all of what you train people in, it's what, you know, what one would have been said. When you learn the basics, you do. And then you sort of move to more advanced languages like Java, Scala, Ruby, whatever you do. I suddenly started seeing that Node.js is picking up full steam, you know, there's Backbone.js and all of that. So I really wanted to explore this space. Right? And that's when I realized, I came across this framework called Knockout.js. Okay? So, how many of you guys have programmed with jQuery? Or have used jQuery? Right? Now, what's the most sort of complicated thing that you've done with jQuery? Just very quickly, someone can shout. What's the most complicated thing that you've done with jQuery? Okay, so I'm going to give you something similar. Extended a pop-up plugin to support iframes. Okay, so in a pop-up show on iframes. Okay, that's good. What about anyone else? Right, so similar stuff. Right? Everyone sort of goes through this, and suddenly, so when you figure out jQuery, you get really excited. You're like, oh, jQuery is so powerful. I can do anything and everything through jQuery. Right? Remember when I started using jQuery, I used to think how I can do backend stuff upfront in the front end, you know, validation. Why push it to the back, do it upfront, right? And then when I realized there's something called a knockout JS, I had a similar feeling all over again. That wow, this is so powerful, right? Why not just do everything with knockout? Okay. So knockout is designed in something called as a view model pattern. Okay. Yeah, so V and VM. Okay, so we all know the MVC, right? Model View Controller Architecture. And those of you familiar with Backbone, Backbone follows the MVC architecture. So what the hell is a VM, VM model? So view is the view that you want to represent, and model is your data, right? Most web applications are all about showing your data in a sexy way, right? Now, there's something called as a view model which fits in between the two. It's like an adapter, okay? So Knockout is a front-end framework that is completely client-side, okay? It can keep data coming in from any sort of request, web services, you know, or JSON, or it can be JSON, XML, any other format, and render it onto your UI, right? So when you use jQuery for complicated tasks, you suddenly start realizing, oh, there should be too many things happening on my interface right now at any given point of time. And suddenly you start seeing that the browser starts crashing, right? And you uninstall Firefox and you reinstall and you start all over again. The problem is that too many things are happening at the same time. For you to keep your page up to date as compared to what your data is showing on the server side, right? So Knockout actually comes in between and does all of this for you. Okay, so today what I'm going to do is sort of show you some of the cool things that Knockout does. And I'm going to take an example that will combine Twitter feed, maps, WebSockets, and of course, Knockout views. Okay, so if you guys have your computers, maybe you could try going to this. Streaming API, right? And so I'm displaying that, and I've given a number 1, 2, 3 depending on when they came into the list, and I'm plotting them on the map, right? I've taken US right now because the location API seems to work better with the US geography, right? And you can see there's a button called disconnect up there. So at any point of time, I can say I want to disconnect. And it will stop the feed. Okay. Additionally, I can say this feed. I want to see what's happening here. You know, where is this feed coming from? So you can see that I'm clicking on a button and I'm moving. Okay. Can you see that it's moving to a particular location? Now, so let's take one example. So you can see that this tweet belongs to this particular marker, right? This tweet belongs to this particular marker. I have a small cross sign here. I'm just going to click on that and another one, and it deletes the marker as well, right? Simple. This is easy. Anyone can write jQuery and remove the marker. But did you see what happened to the list? Can you see that 1, 2, 3 automatically got updated on its own? Right? Okay, so this is sort of the overall thing that we're building, right? So approximately how many lines of code do you think has gone into this? Okay, actually I haven't counted, so I don't know the exact answer. But JMeter layer is extremely small, okay? And that's what we cover sort of right now. So, okay, I'm guessing a lot of people don't have their computers, right? So what we do is, okay, those of you who have your computers, if you can go to this website, right, sameercycle.github.com/knockout-tweet. Are you here? You will see that there are two options, zip and tab, right, you can download either one, okay, and open it up. And you can navigate to this path, Okay, so you, when you download it, you will get it as some random name, right? Just rename it to Knockout PT, and then go into public/standalone. You know, the folder structure, go into public/standalone, and there's an index.html there. Just open that up in your browser, you should be able to play with the same thing. Okay? It's a little slow because I've hosted it on a very small instance. So what that is doing is, that's a front page which is talking to our servers that we have hosted on EC2, which is running the WebSocket program. Okay, so it gets feed from Twitter, passes it through WebSockets, and it gets rendered over here. Okay, cool. So what's so special about Knockout, right? Now, I thought about making slides earlier, but I realized it will be just about, again, replicating, you know, we want a tutorial to last on a blog and some sort of a page which you can search for, right? So I decided it will be easier to go this way. I'm sorry if it's not too easy.
Yeah, public should have
an
index.
No, public/standalone. Go into the folder and then there will be an index for it. Right? So it's asking for your Twitter credentials. You're not storing them, don't forget.
That's
going from Twitter. Yeah. It's going through our service. Okay, guys, can we instead continue?
Yes.
So I want to first show off a few things about Knockout JS. Okay, why is it so impressive? Right? So this is the website called knockoutjs.com. They have some really easy to use documentation, but what I wanted to show you very quickly was this. Right? Suppose you have an example where you have to show a list. Okay? So it could be a list of anything, items or whatever, and you have the condition that you should only add five items. You can't have more than that. Right? In jQuery, what would we have done? We would have maintained sort of the variable which has all the list, or we would have counted how many li items there are, right, and things like that. So we would have taken at least 3, max 4 lines of code. But in Knockout.js, you can see here the second example, right? So your button could be like an add button. If you see that, all it says is data bind equal to enable colon my items dot count is less than 5. Okay, did you guys figure this out? So he's saying this button can be only enabled if the size of my count is less than 5, if it meets that condition. Okay, otherwise it needs to be disabled. Right? In jQuery, you would have to look at the add event, then do a count event, and then do a sort of a update event to the button. That's a 3-step process. Knockout is able to remember, you know, what is happening to your data. And then as soon as there's a change, it affects that change. Okay, so it becomes really easy. Right? Isn't that impressive? It's directly written into HTML.
It doesn't
mean. Okay. Check that. Okay, so similarly, so you saw enabled, right? Similarly, there are other sort of things that you can do. You know, we have other events which are called visible. Right? Can you just see this line? Right? It's saying data bind visible when value for length meets some criteria, which is greater than 0. Right? You will only see this message when values are more than this. Right? So this is what takes me to an interesting point called observables. Okay? Knockout.js has a type called observable. Okay? You can observe a single item, you can subscribe to changes for a single item, or you can have an array of items. Okay? So it will monitor the state of those items and automatically call events and update your UI. Okay? This is a very simple example if you can see over here. Is it readable? Sorry, is the screen readable? Right? So you have something called as, you have a simple object called view model. Okay? And in that you have one element called my values. Okay? And actually it's not one second, so it's not the best. Okay, fine, let's just simply get started. This is very simple, right? You have your HTML here and you have your JavaScript right below it, which is defining the object. Okay? and you can knock out, please listen to the state of this particular sort of class, this object, and then all the elements under it will automatically start, they eventually get activated. Okay. Now I'll come. What I'll do is, actually I want to. So you saw visible, right? You saw simple thing like enabled, visible. Similarly, you have other things like text, HTML, CSS, style, attribute. Okay. So suppose you had a field which you wanted to show the count, like the count of tweets that you have currently in your system, right? You can directly, instead of doing dollar, you know, finding that selector and saying dot text equal to something, over here you can directly say that p element. Can you see that the today's message or whatever that span datafind text is equal to that variable? Okay. I just wanted to use the documentation to just introduce a few lines over here. You know? But what we do is we go into the cooler stuff through the code. Since many of you don't have your computer, what I'll do is I'll pull it up in Eclipse. Okay, is this readable? I can't zoom into this. Is this readable? One second, I'll just do one thing. Eclipse setting does it.
Sort of your tweets container, right? Now the map is very simple. You just use basic map code to put in the map over here. Now this part has again two parts. It has a login box where you can put in your Twitter credentials, and then it has a list. Okay. Now if you are connected, right? If you make a connection, if I make a connection and my WebSocket opens up, it should automatically go into disconnect mode. You know, you don't want to show your login mode anymore, right? And subsequently it creates. Okay, so cool. Now we are ready to discuss this. So this is your map container, right? Is this readable, guys? Right? This is all sort of garbage from our point of view. Now here we start off over here. Okay, so this is my form, right? This is where I'm asking for the username and the password. But you would see there's an interesting thing called visible, and I put a variable saying status, right? So if the status is false, that is if you're not connected, I want to show this form. Okay, it's just as simple as this one line, right? Now for the disconnect box, right? So if the status is true, that is if we are connected, I just want to show the button, right? The danger button, the disconnect button. Okay, finally come down to the tweets, the list. So I have messages over here, okay? And you can see it's just a single line of code, right? All it says is make a template, okay? Use the template called tweet. And this is the list of tweets that I have. Okay, so for each item in this list, draw this template. Okay, now as and when the list gets edited, that you add an element, it'll draw it. If you subtract an element, it'll draw it again. Okay, you don't have to know when, who added, and what happened. Okay, so this is sort of the overall structure of your code. I mean, from an HTML point of view. Okay, let's go down and let's look at our view model. Okay, so I have an object called tweets. Okay, this is my sort of class or function, whatever way you want to look at it. I have two elements. One of them is called a list, which is an observable array. That is, I want to monitor its state. And the other one is called a status. This is, I want to know whether we are connected or not. Right? So just two sort of variables. Right? Now, so let's look at what happens when I want to add a tweet. Okay, we're talking about this. So a tweet comes from somewhere. Okay, all I do is I say list.push that particular JSON object. Okay, as soon as this happens, this goes back to that piece of code which says, you know, render this template, right? Remember? Right? So it says render this template. So this template is called tweet. Now you just look for the template, right? This is the template. Okay? As you can see, it's written in as a script tag, in a script tag called, you know, text/HTML, right? This is only done to, yeah. Absolutely, you could do anything. It's just that it needs to be available when it's drawing it. So what that means is it needs to be loaded before it has been loaded, right? You would have seen the way we've written the code. We've written, we had all our includes right at the top, but we have this particular HTML code, and after this we have our JavaScript code. The reason is because when the page is loading, as the page is loading, knockout reacts to data-bind statements. So if this HTML, if this JavaScript structure was above, right, he would have said, wait, I don't have any element like this, I don't know what to do with this property. So the moment you put him behind, below it, it starts updating the values like this, okay? And so one important thing, when you are trying to learn and experiment with knockout, please use the debug version. Okay, so again, knockout has two formats. The minified gzip version is 13 KB, but the debug is obviously much larger. So you won't know what errors you're facing, right? I mean, those of you who work with jQuery min, right, you know the kind of problems you have. Anyway, so when I get a tweet, when I need to draw a tweet, I need to execute this template. Okay, what does this template say? So you would have seen, you know, on our, when we draw the templates, you would have seen we have these green, sort of they look like yellow over here, but we have these green and we have a sort of a blue tag. Right? What is the difference? The difference is when it's green, it actually has a marker associated with it. It has a geo coordinate. When it's blue, it doesn't have a geo. coordinate, you know, an explicit lat long, right? So I can click on the green ones, and the browser will move to that particular point, right? Will pan to that point, right? Whereas with the blue ones, it will not do anything, right? So let's go to this particular line, right? Now you remember the data is coming like a JSON object, right? If you guys want to see what does your data look like, your data looks like this. Your Twitter screen looks like this. Okay, it's a huge JSON object, extremely well nested and very well done. But as you can see, it has sort of, you know, geo, text, blah blah blah, very well nested.
Isn't screen supposed to be a direction based stimulator?
Yeah. So if you can see my page, you know, see, look at my cursor on the right. Can you see my cursor on the right?
Right.
Over time, you will see it will start slowly moving on top. Okay, because it keeps loading data, keeps pushing data, right? Because it doesn't support WebSockets, you can't directly put it into your HTML page. So I couldn't just give you sort of HTML and say, here, use it. I had to host a server to show it to you guys, right? Anyway, no, the reason why I wanted to show you this object was because of the next line, right? So the span element is just basically drawing that label 1, 2, 3, whatever it is, right? Check out this piece of code. Right? So you're saying data bind visible if data.geo. So that is the JSON object has something called as a geo. You know, that object should be null. If it is null, then make this visible. Okay? And what should be the text? The text is nothing but the position of this particular item in the list. Right? So it automatically gets 1, 2, 3, 4 and all that. If you delete it, it automatically get promoted up. Right? I haven't done anything else. It's just this much. Right? And similarly, if you look at the other guy, the green box, you know, the green box has something called as, you know, draw it if geo is present. I could have said not null instead of this. And again, the position part. And I've added another feature called click. Okay, so this is the function to be called if there's a click. Now, why is this so cool? I could have just written on click or whatever, made this a button and all of that. Right? Now, if you guys remember in jQuery, whenever you have a click event and you do this, right? What does this stand for? It stands. Exactly, the element from which the event is getting triggered, right? So again, I could have done that over here.
10 minutes.
Oh, 10 minutes. Okay. So I could have done that over here, but the problem would have been that I would have not got the data, the latest data of this particular item along with that event. You understand? So if you have a list item and the object keeps changing inside that list, and when someone triggers it, you want to know what is that most updated version. We are using knockouts click event tracker. Okay, so what it'll do?
You are also using knockout to essentially populate the marker on
a
map.
I'll show you. See, populating a marker on a map is just basically saying add marker to the map. Okay, it's not really using knockout. It's when you do it. So I'm doing this while I'm rendering this layout. So as soon as you see a tweet here, you would have seen a marker, corresponding marker as well. Okay, just keep this in mind. Okay, just remember this click pan to function. This is when you click it, it will pan to that particular part. I'll just complete this block so that we all have, you know, clarity. Okay, this is fairly simple. We are drawing the image, we are putting the image, right? Image tag, src tag is coming from directly the JSON structure, right? Similarly, the text, that is a tweet message, is coming directly from the screen name, is coming directly from there, right? And your this is your tweet, right? So text, so this is the actual tweet, that this is going to just display the text over there, right? Now the amazing part is, you can just directly use variables like this, right? Earlier I did data.geo, I could have just said geo. I can just say text, right? So it will actually go into the JSON object and it will pull out the element text. And that text could be an array, it could be a map, it could be anything, right? So you can directly start using how you reference JSON objects over here itself. And this is finally the delete. We have a cross I showed you, right? How you can delete. And again, this also has a click event, okay, which is using data byte and not on click. Okay, so this is how we draw the element on the right. Okay, we're almost done. The only part that is left is markers for the map, which is fairly trivial. What I'll do is I'll skip to you remember I showed you this function called pan tool. Right? Now pan tool can take two parameters, data, comma, event. An event will have the reference to which particular object got clicked. Okay, but I'm only interested in the data part of things, so I've just taken one variable, one argument. This data is the most updated element data in that list, that JSON object in that list, right? So all I can do is directly I can say I have added the marker, basically I created a marker and I put it back into the JSON object, okay? And I said go to that particular position, right? Now this is, see, in jQuery, if you had done on click, you would have got that particular element, then you would have found out where in that list is that element and then done. Or you would have used the dot data property of jQuery, or you would have put some extra class or some other shady thing, right? Over here, we don't have to think about anything. Have a question?
Yeah. Was it a necessity to skip data or no, I'm calling pan tool only for those
which had a geo. Right. You're saying this one, right? Yeah. So I could have done it differently.
You could have done it without it.
Yeah, so if you want to see my add marker, my add marker code, right? So sorry, one second, let me just go back up here. If you remember this, this was how we were iterating through the list, right? We were calling the tweet template, and there's another third property called after render. So what this does is after rendering each element, it will call this particular function, add marker. Okay? Now, add marker is defined like this. So add marker takes elements comma data, okay? In that data I'm checking, data is the JSON object that we had got, which directly I put into the list. So I'm checking whether it has a geo object or whether I've already created a marker for it. You know, sometimes when you're reordering, you don't want it to redraw the marker again because you will get two points on the same point, right? That doesn't, for the same tweet. So what I do is I get the coordinates and then I generate a lat-long object and then I store the marker and I store the marker into the data itself. Okay, I did this over here, right? I updated this data object over here and this is updating the entire list. Okay, this is really cool, right? So what this allows us to do is generate really complicated UI without having to know, you know, the overall sort of where do I fit into the overall scheme of things, right? I don't need to know which position do I belong into that list and stuff like that, right? And remove marker is fairly simple, right? So we just remove the marker and I just do data marker equal to null and finally I say list.remove this. Remember I was saying this, the jQuery this, remember we were discussing that? Over here this reference that particular item in the list. Okay, so this is a little complicated. So if you can, you know, avoid, I mean, fully understand what does this mean. So if I had called this function from another object, this would have meant that particular object. Okay, so, you know, so that's why what we do is we reference, we create a variable called self. Okay, I hadn't talked about this earlier. We create an element called self. So what self does is, it will store the original context of tweets. So if I ever want to know the supermost sort of element, right, I can always use self. But otherwise, for all other purposes, I can use this. Right? Cool. So I think what would be good is if you guys can check out the project, you can simply check out the project and I can keep the servers up and running, or you can run it locally, right? This is the sort of the URL for that particular project. Any questions, thoughts, comments? Have you seen something better? I'm talking not my code, I'm talking about knockout JS.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So,
the Stack Overflow question which debates this, and both sides of the argument, you know, both sides are very well argumented, and you know, they're saying, oh, this is great. But I think from our point of view, see, Backbone.js has an MVC architecture, right? So, it's very good when you're trying to build a single page UI, you know, which will support, which will have an entire MVC architecture. See, right, you have to initially, Backbone requires you to write a lot of code. You know, you'll have to define all your model to controller and then start using it. Right? Whereas with knockout, you can just simply start. Okay, so that's one difference between the two. The second is, now you may argue that, okay, if you can't do MVC, then that's a big problem. Right? So there's something else called Sammy.js which you can connect. I'm not making it up just because my name is Sammy, I don't know the name. But there's something called as Sammy.js which you can connect. Okay? The second is that explicitly Backbone.js does not bind your data and view together. You need to write a lot more code to make that happen. So if you are writing a UI which requires you to constantly make Ajax requests and you're getting data or you have web sockets open, right? And you want your UI to automatically adapt with very little lines of code, then I'd say use knockout. If you're building a complex UI, a single page UI, right, and you have the time, use Backbone.js. Out of the two, Backbone.js is an older project and therefore has, you know, much bigger developer community. But knockout is getting there. For final details, check that Stack Overflow question. Anything else?
Does knockout.js, I mean, require that data to be like a dynamic stream, or it can just be like any, can it be like a video and stuff, or it should just be like some Twitter feed or like?
Yeah, so it can be any JSON or JavaScript object. I mean, at the end of the day, you can convert anything into JSON or JavaScript object, right? So whether it's text, XML, etc., you can always store them there. Yeah, but you can connect through Ajax, web sockets, anything, anyhow. Even if the user types in, you can also use that as, that's also a stream of data. Cool? Okay guys, thank you.